Good morning. It is Tuesday, November the 9th, and this is The Drill. Welcome to all the butchers, bakers, and candlestick makers out there. I'm Ron, your host, and the only true conservative in the United States today. So today we will have the Daily Declaration for Spiritual Warfare, Pledge of Allegiance, Sing the Star-Spangled Banner, and America the Beautiful. Then we'll have commentary, all that, and more when I come back. Thank you. And now the Daily Declaration for Spiritual Warfare for November 9th. I have brought you into my kingdom, my child, the kingdom of God. My kingdom is within you. In my kingdom, the righteous will flourish, and the earth will be filled with the knowledge of my ways. I long for my kingdom to spread over the earth, but whom shall I send? And who will go for me to bring the world into my kingdom? Like my servant Isaiah, will you go for me? My greatness is unsearchable. Declare my mighty acts and my awesome deeds and greatness. Sing of my righteousness, for I am gracious and full of compassion and good to all. Speak of the glories of my kingdom, for it is an everlasting kingdom that endures throughout all generations. Depart from those who harden their hearts and will not listen, and reason daily with all who hear the word and will accept my ways. Prayer Declaration. Your throne, O God, is forever and ever. You hold a scepter of righteousness in your hand and anoint your people with the oil of gladness. You are clothed with honor and majesty. You walk on the wings of the wind and make the clouds your chariot. How manifold are your works! The earth is full of your possessions. I will sing praise to you while I have my being, and I will show forth your wonders to all your people. And that was the Daily Declaration for Spiritual Warfare for November 9th. I read this because the essence of what it is that we're fighting is the devil. And there's very little talk in our society anymore. It used to be that we heard a lot about the devil and Satan and the works of the devil and Satan. And we hear very little about it. And I want to remind people, ultimately our battle is a religious battle and it's against the devil. Thank you. And so I was thinking about the Hillary Clinton campaign of 2016 And it occurred to me that one of the reasons that she lost was that she was not running a campaign, a Hillary for president campaign kind of campaign. She was running a socialistic campaign. In socialism, the individual is insignificant. It is the masses that count and matter. It is movements, large movements of large amounts of people that matter. And that Hillary Clinton was running as a woman's movement candidate. That in socialism, in that instance, it doesn't matter which woman becomes president, only that a woman becomes president. And it was clear from her campaign thinking about it that that's the way it was shaping up. Donald Trump versus a woman for president. And I know this, and what really reinforces this is her slogan, "I'm with her." She didn't say, "I'm with Hillary." I'm with her. Generic, general woman. So, again, and what Americans are expecting, because Donald Trump didn't have I'm with him. It didn't break down to men versus women. It was a real individual, Donald Trump, and what his promises were for this country versus generic woman. And basically, her campaign came down to, don't you really want a woman for president? Okay, no promises, no reasons as to why it is that a woman would be a better president. And more specifically, again, why would she be the better president? Because we can't give the presidency to women, for instance. Who's the president of the United States? Well, all the women of the United States are president. No, that doesn't work. It's going to go to an individual, and the individual has to campaign as such. And this is another demonstration, by the way, of what I really find so offensive about people like Hillary Clinton is that they're always looking for workarounds. They're always looking for loopholes. Okay, they don't want to obey the law. They don't want to obey the Constitution. They want to find a way to work around the Constitution. They want to look for what they think of are loopholes in the Constitution, exploitable loopholes. And there aren't any. There's no loopholes in the Constitution. There's no workarounds. If Hillary Clinton doesn't like the United States the way it is, I respect that. You don't have to. There's remedies. It's called constitutional amendments and or sitting down having a constitutional convention. Having a constitutional convention would be an absolute disaster. There's at least one lawyer that thinks it's a great idea, and he wrote a book about it. But he's the worst voice on radio and a complete moron. He's so gullible, it's frightening. It's just absolutely frightening. And the demonstration of that to gullibility is the gerrymandering situation in California today. Why is it that Democrats dominate the state? Because they have succeeded in gerrymandering the entire state, in dividing this up into Democrat and Republican districts. Okay, so that's why they dominate. Because what happened, the people voted for a constitutional amendment not a referendum, but initiative process, okay? So that said that the districts will no longer be written up by the legislature. The legislature normally does this. It is going to be done by a citizen committee. And there's instructions on who is going to get picked and how they're going to get picked, et cetera, et cetera. So this comes to being. It comes it passes. It becomes law. Then the first thing that the Democrats did, the Republicans took it in good faith. Okay, fine. So now we're going to try and go. We're going to put this together, get a citizens committee, ostensibly just of random people. You know, random people, some might be communists, some might be libertarians or whatever. And they just get put on this committee and then they go ahead and gerrymander. But the Democrats saw a power opportunity and they rigged the system so that they ended up with on the commission a majority of Democrats. They rigged it. And so we end up now with Democrats all over the state. And now we're stuck with a system, a gerrymandering system that guarantees that the Democrats will remain in power in perpetuity. Okay, so that's where that situation is. And so the same thing goes with if you have a constitutional convention, every socialist and fellow traveler in this country is going to get to that convention, hook or by crook, if they have to hitchhike, if they have to walk, whatever it is, they're going to get there and they're going to do everything within their power to rig the game. And we're all going to get screwed. See, because we're going to have the people that are taking this in good faith are going to have as our representatives the gullible fools like this particular lawyer on the radio. They're going to be our representatives, and they're going to go in and say, everybody play nice, and the Democrats will be smiling and nodding their heads while they're busy having their operatives rig the game. And then we're going to end up with the United Socialist States of America, and then we'll all sit back and say, how did this happen? And it happened because idiots like Mark Levin, gullible idiots like Mark Levin, because of them and their stupidity. So that's the last thing that we want is a constitutional convention. But it is an option. That's my point. If you want to change, there's people that make the claim that the Constitution is outdated, that Herbert Crowley made that observation back in 1900. He wrote a book called The Promise of American Life, in which he went on and on about complaining about the United States of America and the Constitution and how it was really fine for an agrarian society, but now that we're an industrial society, we really have to have something else. Fine, get a constitutional amendments, get a campaign for a constitutional, I just had that a second ago. For a constitutional convention. There we go. So go ahead and campaign for it. That's within the law. That's your perfect right to do so. I don't see that it's necessary, so I'd vote against it. But the point is there's a right way to do things and a wrong. And Hillary Clinton and her ilk always want to do it the wrong way. They want to ignore the Constitution so that at some point they can say, hey, look, America, the Constitution doesn't work. Nobody's paying attention to it anyway. So why don't we just scrap it and all become socialists? And that's what really, again, grinds my axe about Hillary Clinton, people like that. But the bottom line here is one of the biggest reasons that the Hillary Clinton campaign lost is because Hillary never ran. Who was running was generic woman. Generic woman versus Donald Trump. Okay, and if it had been the other way, generic man versus Hillary Clinton, I'd have probably voted for Hillary Clinton. And so again, you put up generic woman versus Donald Trump. I'm voting for Donald Trump every time. I want a real person for president of the United States, not an idea or an ambition. Thank you. I was watching on Squawk Box yesterday on CNBC the talk about Tesla. Tesla shares were down and whatnot. One of the things, though, that Mr. Elon Musk is doing is he's and it's just stunning. But anyways, he is saying that he's going to go ahead and take 10% of his stock and he'll sell it for the purposes of paying taxes if everybody agrees to it. He's going to put it out on Twitter and he's going to let the people, I guess, decide, or at least whoever it is that happens to bother Twitter, decide whether or not he should sell those shares. And so last I heard, the consensus, if you will, is that he should. So this is stupid. And the reason he's doing it is because he says that there's a lot of talk about millionaires, billionaires that hide their money by not realizing their gains. So they hold on to stock, and as the stock appreciates, the only way right now in the tax code that you can go ahead and tax that money is when the gains are realized. When he sells his shares, when he cashes out, it's considered income, which is, makes perfect sense. You're not, you can't have an in, you tax an income that doesn't exist. Okay, so that's where he's at with that. So his whole idea is, okay, well, I don't know. I guess he's going to show to everybody what a badass he is. Or maybe he thinks that this is a leadership opportunity and that by him doing it, that other people will be emboldened to do the same thing. First of all, what he's doing and a lot of people on the right are doing, all the reactionaries are agreeing with the premise. So once you agree with this, the premise here, you lose. There's no way to win. And the premise is that, not only just that basically the rich aren't paying their fair share, but there's no way to know that. Okay, this is one of those fallacies. A fallacy is something that sounds good at first blush, it sounds good, but when you investigate, when you think about it, you realize it's false. And that's what happens here. At first, it sounds great. Well, you know, because why do we buy into this? Because we all do it. We all want to pay our fair share, but not a nickel more. And the same thing goes with the, your millionaire, billionaire, whatever. They're same thing. They want to pay their fair share, but not a nickel more. But anyways, the left comes out and says, well, billionaires aren't paying their fair share. So we buy into that premise. And what was behind that premise is they're pretending that they know how much the billionaires pay. There's no possible way to know because it's a matter of privacy. And don't believe me on this. Think about back to the Trump campaign in 2016. What was one of the big issues? And it was a sideline issue with the Trump campaign was, we want to see your tax returns. And Donald Trump said, no, you don't get to see my tax returns. And that's the way it is. My tax returns are between me and the IRS, nobody else. So there's no possible way anyone can know what I pay, if I pay, or whether or not I pay my fair share. So by engaging the left in an argument over whether or not the superstars should pay their fair share, you're acknowledging that they don't. You are creating that reality. The fact of the matter is nobody knows. I don't know what you pay in taxes. You don't know what I pay in taxes. Nobody knows what Donald Trump, except Donald Trump and his accountant and the IRS know about Donald Trump's taxes. So don't be fooled by this. When you hear people saying, well, the rich aren't paying their fair share, the first thing you should do is ask them, how do you know? And watch, and you'll look at their face, and their mouth is going to be open, and they're going to have nothing to say because they hadn't even considered it. So again, remember, as far as whether or not the rich pay their fair share, nobody knows. Thank you, thank you. I ran into a little bit of a conundrum the other day because I've railed against neutrality. I've argued that there is really no such thing as neutrality for a human being. You can't be neutral. You are a human being, therefore you're biased automatically. You're biased in favor of human beings. You're biased in favor of yourself. You're biased in favor of your family, your wife, your husband, whomever. You're biased, you're biased, you're biased, you're biased. Okay, and then it's just a question of where your biases lie, and that the best policy is simply to be honest about your biases. Come out and be candid. I'm a male, I'm a Christian, I'm whatever the deal is, so we know where your biases lie. And then we can, every time you state an opinion, we'll take your biases into consideration. So, but there's so many people like Hugh Hewitt that want to be neutral because they think that there's some power in neutrality, that somehow being neutral has more integrity, more credibility, and because it's more realistic. Okay, but the problem is that, yes, reality is objective, but it doesn't sell. Neutrality doesn't sell. So if reality is objective, therefore neutral, then how do you sell it? How do you sell that? How do you sell conservative? How do you sell anything and maintain maximum objectivity and maximum integrity? Not objectivity, really, it's credibility and integrity. And the answer to this seeming conundrum is the fact that, yes, reality is objective, but it's experienced subjectively. And so you're going to sell, but you're going to make sure that you are candid about the fact, number one, that you're selling, and about what you're selling. One of the big problems for Hugh Hewitt is he won't declare a position. He won't come out and say, I'm a conservative, and this is what it means to be conservative. He comes out and says, well, he's middle right or right of center or whatever it is that he is. He won't even do it Christian-wise. He won't even come out and say, I'm a Catholic. Okay? He fudges that and says that he's Catholic and Protestant at the same time. He goes to a Presbyterian church and he goes to a Catholic church. You know, I don't know, maybe he thinks that's supposed to give him credibility, but actually, if he wanted maximum credibility, shouldn't he then also go to synagogue and mosque, right? Shouldn't he be all of the Abrahamic religions? Isn't that what's going to give him maximum credibility? No. What gives you credibility is, again, disclosing your biases. I'm a Christian, and then you don't have to explain that every time you make an opinion. In my Christian opinion, you state it as a fact as you know it. State things as facts as you know them. And the rest of us that are listening, we will go ahead and take into consideration, oh, okay, well, but also he's a Christian, he's Catholic, he's whatever, he's a lawyer, that kind of thing. We'll take that into consideration. So again, reality is, yes, objective, but it's experienced subjectively. Thank you, thank you. The change, the culture, and how it affects us on a daily basis. In our culture today, we have a constant reminder and a constant drive for constant change. I've heard on the television about everything is in constant flux. Baloney. Hogwash. But how does that affect us in our day-to-day life? Why is that not just an academic exercise as to whether or not there is a change or not change and to what degree? Well, I had an experience at the grocery store that reminds me of this attitude that is prevalent and this constant change attitude. I went through the line, the grocery line, and I asked for bags. And as a matter of fact, I asked for 3 bags. And the lady said, instead of just saying, yes, thank you, or yes, please, or whatever, and giving me the 3 bags, she wanted to argue about it. She wanted to make a suggestion. She wanted to suggest a change. And the change was to get 2 bags instead of 3. And so I had to be firm about it. And I said, 3 bags. I'm not going to, because I know where this is going and I'm not going to sit here at 6:30 in the morning, engaging in a debate with the clerk about how many bags I want. It's a customer service issue. And I guess that's the ultimate point I'm trying to make, is why it is we no longer really have customer service is because we have too many people that are promoting change, that look at everything in terms of change. How can I make things better? And I'm sure she sees herself, this lady, this checkout lady, as being a change agent, a leader and a change agent. And that her job is to get up in the morning and walk around looking for things to change and making suggestions to people about how they can change and do things that are better. And I suppose that her bag idea is probably some kind of an environmental issue, but it isn't. It's really a property issue. I am buying those bags, 10 cents a piece. And once I buy those bags, they become my property to do with as I see fit and to dispose of as I see fit. So, but again, she sees herself as a leader. She sees that, or pretends that, or has been brainwashed to believe that the earth and the world and the universe are in constant flux and that everything is about change. And so that's the way she approaches everything, is to look at the world through the prism of change. How can I always make things better? And how this affects the individual is, again, you get to the point where you're afraid to open your mouth. You're afraid to say anything to anybody because you're going to get that suggestion coming back. Sometimes people will actually have the decency to at least ask, can I suggest something? And my answer to that always is no. Thank you anyway. That's why it's important. The reality of the fact is that we make the presumption for the status quo. We do what we do until there's an obvious case for change. Three bags means three bags unless there's an obvious... In other words, she should have offered two bags only if there were only two bags left in the store. And then there's an obvious case for change. But otherwise, it becomes a gratuitous change, and it's stressful. Promoting gratuitous change is stressful. But again, this is what we're brainwashed to believe by television, by movies, everything, all of our cultural books, magazines, to believe that the universe is in constant flux, when we obviously know better than that. The earth is not in constant flux. It's 24 hours a day, 365 days in a year, and that remains constant. It was that way. It's that way today. It was that way 100 years ago, 1,000 years ago, 1,000,000 years ago, and it'll be that way 1,000,000 years from now. That's not constant flux. That's consistency. And with consistency comes reliability. We can rely on it. We can set our watches, our clocks. We can have banking systems. We can do all the things that an acknowledgement of reality, in this case, consistency, gives us. Thank you. Thank you. Over the weekend, I saw news items on Saturday morning, as a matter of fact, where a couple was arrested for going into a bakery and actually ended up getting into a fist fight with the owner of the bakery over masks. And they brought their camera with them and were filming the whole thing. And so this was obviously something that they planned to do. The way the mask thing seems to break down is that the people that are pro-mask mandate are usually socialists, lefties, liberals, whatever you want to call them, that are coming down in favor of mask mandates. And it is the Republicans and conservatives and traditionalists that are coming down on the opposite side. So in this particular case, these people who may think of themselves as conservative are not. When they go in looking for trouble, because that's what they did, and we know that because they brought their camera with them, and they go in and then announce, we're not going to wear our masks, and we demand service anyhow. That's not conservative. You're looking for trouble, number one. Number two is you are not understanding the issue, and the issue here is property rights. And every true conservative respects property rights. If the owner of that store says you have to wear a mask, then you wear a mask. If they say you got to take your shoes off, if you got to genuflect or bow, or they've got, Ganesh, or the Hindu god with the elephant with 5, 6, 10 arms on him or whatever, you got to come in and bow down to him or make an offering to him. That's what you have to do, or you leave and go somewhere else. But it's their property. They get to do with it as they see fit. And my job as a conservative is to respect their property and property rights. Okay. I don't like what's going on. I go somewhere else. That's conservative. Okay. These folks ended up making not only a fool out of themselves, but they make every conservative in this country look bad. and make the traditionalists, everybody on the right, let's put it that way, make all of us look like idiots if they wanted to be more effective. Because right now, all that is just two people who, two right-wing individuals that are going into a store, and then the worst part of it is wrestling with the owner over this. Come on. You got to be kidding. So they commit battery. They end up getting arrested. So good. I'm glad that they're arrested. But don't think that they are conservative. They're not. They're reactionary. Reactionary traditionalists, not conservative. And so don't think that you have to ape their behavior in order to be a conservative. Now, if you want to act in a more conservative way and you feel that or think that you have a damn good reason to go in there and make your point known, then what you do is you gather up 50 of your friends and then you call the news crews and say, guess what? Me and 50 of my closest friends are going into this bakery and we're going to go in there without our masks and demand service. So, you know, you tell them, okay, either give me service or call the police and put them on the spot. Okay, so that's a protest. That's a political statement. But if it's just you, it's a personal statement and not a very good one. And thank you. And I wanted to remind you that I have a book for sale called it's a companion book to my podcast, and it's called The Drill. It's on Kindle, $2.99, or if you have Kindle Unlimited, you can read it for free. So, and now we have, in about a week, I will have the second edition due out. So, and also I want to remind everybody to take a listen to John and Ken show, KFI AM 640 from 2 to 6 p.m. in the afternoons Pacific time. And of course, you can also listen to their podcast, but excellent way, you know, excellent. You can learn more about what it sounds like to be and communicate conservative, to think and communicate conservatively. So, and also bring back Brian Suits. Brian Suits is a KF guy, was former KFI guy on the radio Saturdays and Sunday nights that I really enjoyed listening to, and they've replaced him. The guy, the latest guy they replaced him with is a news guy, which is fine. He's got a good voice. That's great. But it's a rehash of news stories that he's covered in the past. So at least with Brian Suits, we're getting things that are more current event oriented. And so, you know, we have something to look forward to. Whereas with this new guy, Steve, again, it's just past rehashes of old stories. So bring back Brian Suits. So with that said, then I want to remind everybody to be smart, be beautiful, be honest, and remember that the left has no authority, no power, and they can't win.